I have no idea. I do not read your letters, but they keep arriving and I keep giving them to you.
And I keep hoping.
We all keep hoping for your success, Miss Marge. The whole boarding house keeps hoping. You have us all on edge.
My dear Miss March, I have read your story. Well, he's read it. Unfortunately, I find your tales tasteless and vulgar, not at all suitable for my readers. My advice to you...
My advice to you is to return home and have babies. This is what women are made for. Sincerely, F. Putnam.
22.
22?
22 rejections since I've been in New York. They all say the same thing. Go home. Give up.
F. Putnam is an idiot. His words are stupid.
F. Putnam is one of the most powerful publishers in the city.
You cannot lose faith, Miss March. There will be someone who will love your story. I'm certain of that.
Actually, Professor, could I read my story to you? I would so respect your opinion.
Yes, of course.
Actually, it's one of my best. It was a dark and stormy night. The moors are bleak and bloody. Thunder claps, lightning strikes. The fair forest overflows in disarray, races across the wild forest. Now she stops. Now she runs. Will she escape? Will she be caught? With full determination, the villainous aristocrat grasps in Prendergast. Lurches for her! There's no escape. She's but a child, and yet she turns to fight with eyes ablaze. This noble girl meets his gaze unafraid. She will not be defiled.
Keep away from me, you wretch!
I cannot keep away your beauty. Draws me. Your passion ignites me. I've got to have you.
I defy you.
That's a fool of you.
So come to me.
I'll have her. And the mother, too.
In that moment, Rodrigo appears in magnificent splendor.
I have that woman! Villain!
Who are you?
I am your destiny, your bitterest fate. So what's rightly mine 10 long years ago? You left me cold, alone, and forgotten. Now I beg to settle the score.
Miss March! Tell me what you are trying to write here.
Blood and guts stuff. It's all the rage. The newspapers and periodicals are full of it.
Violence and seduction on every page.
Read Shakespeare. Read history. The newspaper.
It's getting late. Perhaps we should pursue this subject some other time.
No, I want to know what you think.
Blood and guts stuff. Is that what you think the world wants to hear? If I've noticed something about you, Miss March, it's that you are unique. Something you should try not to forget. I think you can do better.
Better? And who are you, some aging German professor close to 50?
I am 34.
34? Really? Well, you look a lot older.
I worry a lot.
And just what do you worry about?
About how to avoid a conversation such as this. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm off to dinner. Miss March, since you arrived here, it's been 6 weeks now. You shout, you rant, you upset the whole order of this boarding house. I am a serene and peaceful man.
You're aloof, you're arrogant.
Arrogant? Miss March, I spoke my mind as you spoke yours. Obviously, it was not appreciated on either side.
Obviously, my stories were a great success in Concord.
Better than what? Better than this dazzling plot? Better, this story will be my pick clear. Each phrase is better, better than ever. Better, even my me be true if I don't succeed? What will I do? Turn around, go back to Concord, leave New York behind unconquered? No, how dare he make me doubt the way I feel, doubt that each thrilling page is who I am. I have risen to the occasion and written us an operatic tragedy.
And we're going to perform it for Christmas.
No! I can't! Not with my flat nose!
Joe, do you really think we're going to vote with this awful war?
When have we let anything defeat us? Years from now, people will talk about us. Poor penniless and ragged sisters put on an operatic tragedy for all of Concord.
All of Concord!
Filled with blood and guts. Two massacres, a mass ball, and several heart-wrenching scenes. The crowd will hush, except the overture, in fact, will surely blush. And when Clarissa starts to plead, Christmas will see the streets.
So, do I die again in this one?
Yes, but many people die like mine before. The world will shudder when your body hits the floor, or when Rodrigo makes you leave. Christmas will exceed our finest dreams.
Ready to tonight. Another.
I want you to get Annie Moffat to invite me to her state Valentine's Day ball.
I'll ring her bloody little bell if she doesn't.
Another.
I want you to get us a Christmas tree.
Rodrigo will go chop one down immediately.
Where?
There, across the way.
That's on Mr. Lawrence's property.
He'll go to prison for it.
Prison? What care I for prison?
Joe is an incredible human being.
Look, there's Mr. Lawrence standing at his window glaring out.
He looks sinister.
I think he looks sad.
I wouldn't be sad living in such a house.
Has anyone ever been inside?
He would never let any of us in.
They say he's a very angry and bitter man. Joe's going to get us into deathly trouble.
He'll be known as the family with a criminal sister.
What criminal sister?
Marty!
You're home!
What's going on here?
Joe's written an operatic tragedy,
and she's invited all of Concord to come see us perform it.
And I play the mother in it, and I die in it.
But it's a beautiful death, and I am Marty, who's very sweet.
It sounds wonderful.
Marty, it's Joe's bed. Tell us about your day.
Well, we needed socks and blankets for the Soldiers' Aid Society, and a letter came from Father.
A letter from Father?
Read it to us, Marmy.
Well, where's Joe?
She's outside.
We'll wait for Joe.
Read the letter, Marmy.
We'll wait.
She may be ours.
Well, I want to hear all the things that you did today.
Well,
Rodrigo has returned.
Joe?
Marmy.
I borrowed it from Mr. Lawrence.
No, you didn't.
I took it for us, Marmy.
Well, you'll take it back immediately.
Take it back? That's like taking back a chicken after you've already cut off its head.
Come let us keep it.
It's Christmas, Marmy.
No, destroying someone else's property.
Well, we could give it to the Hummels. They have so little.
All right, the tree goes to the Hummels then. Now, what about Mr. Lawrence?
What about him?
Mr. Lawrence!
Yes, Mr. Lawrence. You.
Me.
You chopped my perfect Douglas fir. I should have you arrested.
I'll make it up to you, sir.
With what?
I'll paint 6 more.
12.
I'll chop your firewood for a few days.
Weeks. And I hope such an incident like this never happens again. You've ruined my day.
He loves his trees. I'm Theodore Lawrence III, but everybody calls me Lori. I've come to live here in Concord. I can play the piccolo, I can sleep standing up, and I once won a medal for holding my breath nearly 3 minutes before passing out. I think it was terrifically daring of you to chop down grandfather's tree. Well, goodbye.
Theodore Lawrence III! Would you mind taking this tree to the Hummels?
Joe!
I don't mind.
He doesn't mind.
Just point me in the direction.
They live half a mile down the road, the red house with the broken shingles.
Merry Christmas!
Merry Christmas.
Joe, you must think before you act on every whim.
He just wanted us to have a wonderful Christmas, Marmy.
A letter's come from Father, Super Columbus.
Here he's the Marmy.
My dear wife, the war goes on and on. The end seems nowhere in sight. The days are difficult and long, but I am well.
He's well.
Still, it is very lonely away from my dear ones, especially lonely as Christmas is approaching. Each night in my tent, I think of my precious girls.
He thinks of us.
Give them all my love and give them sweetness. Tell them to be good girls, faithful and hardworking, and to conquer that which is disagreeable in them. So that when I return, I will be fonder and prouder than ever of my little women. Well, why are we looking so glum? Do we have an operatic tragedy to perform or not?
We do!
Then we have work to do. Costumes complete, and we know we have work for you to paint.
Will you perform something with us, Marmy?
Yeah, Marmy!
I'll write something with passion and daring.
Yes, I will. We'll make this the best Christmas ever. We March Women are invincible.
I'll bring my oil paint!
All of your costume for Marmy!
I'll design the handbag!
I still don't understand why we couldn't have kept the tree.
Your work day with me begins at 9. You missed reading to me, and you still haven't fixed the latch in the cellar door.
I got delayed, finding you this beautiful flower.
Don't trifle with me, Josephine. You were dawdling.
I wasn't dawdling. I was writing a story.
You are what happens to a girl when she has no father.
I have a father.
Never there when you need him. And now my nephew has the audacity to be an army chaplain, meaning he can't even support his own family. Listen to me, Josephine. You are on the verge of womanhood.
Christopher Columbus.
And just look at you. You go about writing senseless stories, constantly trying to save the world, and you can't save yourself.
I don't need saving.
There are many pitfalls a girl can fall into, and Josephine, you are headed towards all of them. I want to see you shine, even if you aren't rich. You can at least marry now.
Oh, I'll never marry.
Oh, you'll marry. All girls marry.
Well, I'm not all girls.
With a good marriage, you have power. You can take your place in society.
I don't give two figs about society.
Well then, I guess there's no point in our having this conversation. It's clear to me I could never take you to Europe.
Take me to Europe?
It was an idle thought of mine.
Aunt March, you know it's my dream. You know how important it is for a writer to travel.
We earn our dreams in this world, Joseph. It's foolish of me to think that you could ever change your ways.
I
could try. You can never bend your will. You can never follow through. You can never bite your tongue, though your tongue might split in two. If you want to live your dreams, these are the things you have to do. How could you change? You can't, not you.
I could change if I wanted to.
Could you practice self-control? Could you possibly be shy? Could you ever trust in tight in that heat of mid-July? These rules you must obey, everyone but you. You'll never change. You won't, that's why. Yet somewhere deep in my heart do you believe.
Good.
it's getting quite late.
Wait till you see them, Army.
To think my two oldest daughters are attending their first ball. Next year will be you, Beth.
Me? You think so?
Meg!
I can't go.
Meg, why not?
Look at me. Every girl in Concord my age has been to a ball. This is the very first time I've worn a dress like this. Anything like this.
I wore that very same dress to my first ball, and it didn't look half so good on me. Margaret March, you've been dreaming of attending Annie Moffat's St. Valentine's Day ball for months. You can't walk away from it now.
I'm not built for gowns.
You look very alluring.
I think the word is alarming, Marnie. Yes, Beauty. Look at her. She'll be the most sought-after girl at the ball.
She doesn't want to go.
Dead? What will I do when someone asks me to dance?
You'll smile and say, I'm
Thank you.